scripture this morning is found in Matthew 25, verses 31 through 46. When the Son of Man comes in His glory, and all the angels with Him, He will sit on His throne in heavenly glory. All the nations will be gathered before Him, and He will separate the people from one another, as the shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on His right and the goats on His left. Then the King will say to those on His right, "Come, you are blessed by my Father. Take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since creation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in. I needed clothes and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. I was in prison and you came to visit me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?" The King will reply, "I tell you the truth, whatever you did for the least one of these brothers of mine, you did for me." Then he will say to those on his left, "Depart from me, you who are cursed into eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger and you did not invite me in. I needed clothes and you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison and you did not look after me." They will also answer, "Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or needing clothes or sick or in prison and did not help you?" And he will reply, "I tell you the truth, whatever you did not do for one of the least of these, you did not do for me." Then they will go away to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Strong words of our King, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. But God did promise that He would come again and that He would judge us on that day. This is the final parable in the final sermon in Matthew, Jesus. Those previous three parables, the ones with the talents and the bridesmaids and the unfaithful servants, they all stress waiting and preparing for the return of Christ. We know what's going to happen. This parable, however, brings home the reality of this judgment. You hear the words of Christ Himself saying that this will happen one day. We learn firsthand from Him, the King of all kings, how we are going to be judged and separated as sheep and goats. Now, this isn't your ordinary livestock show at the county fair. There's a lot more at stake involved than a big blue ribbon. There's a lot going on here. So what are the stakes that are involved? Jesus makes it crystal clear, but not before separating them. All nations, everybody, that's all of us. Goats to the left and the sheep will be to the right. And it's not immediately clear whether or not you'd rather be a sheep or a goat at that time. But in that day, we know that sheep were more valuable. So I think I would definitely want to be a sheep. I definitely want to be to the right here. I saw a sign in the yard, "Get right or get left." And it doesn't take long to learn what the stakes are, eternal punishment or eternal life. Both involve an eternity. Then the King, our Lord and Savior Jesus, will say to those on the right, the sheep. And here's the thing. If we're alive during this judgment, if we happen to be one of those that are still here, if we know the scripture, we know what side we want to be on. We know that if we look up and we're not on His right, that's not good. We know that. Jesus says, if you're on the right, your inheritance, yours since the creation of everything, blessed by my Father, Jesus says, prepared and waiting for you. And according to this, We know that, both groups that are present that day, we know that both of those groups refer to Jesus as the King. They refer to him as Lord. They know who he is. They acknowledge who he is. They know him or know of him, but do they truly know him? There's a difference. And according to Jesus, there's a big difference. We live in one of the wealthiest countries in the world. It's amazing the things that I look back at, the things I take for granted. And I think when Brother Chad was here, he really shined a light on just simple blessings that we have. How many of you open up your refrigerator and you've got a choice of what you want to eat? We take things like that for granted when you throw that light switch and the lights come on. And that's at the time with Brother Chad, I think I really started paying attention just how blessed we truly are to be right here. I looked up the poorest country in the world, the Central Africa Republic. Their gross income for a whole year is $639. For a whole year. And they don't take days off. If they can find work, they work every day. A whole year. And a lot of people make that in a week. $639. Their life expectancy there for women is 48 years. Oh, for men it's 45. They don't have proper health care. And it's sad. Society as a whole is guilty of assuming that those with more power and more money or more prestige are the ones that deserve the most attention. But on that day, Jesus is coming back. Jesus says that's not the case. That's not how it is. The least powerful, the least noticeable, those low rungs on the social ladder, that's who deserves our attention. The hungry, the needy, those that are in prison. Jesus doesn't say that they're part of the world that's in need, but they are Jesus himself. That's me you're looking at, he says, when you see someone hungry. Our treatment or kindness and generosity to those in need means that we will be judged. That's the means in which we will be judged. And this parable is similar to the rich man and Lazarus and the time to repent. The time to help that need. Well, it's come and gone. On that day, it'll be too late to decide that you want to help someone. I think about that song, the Garth Brooks song, If Tomorrow Never Comes. Beautiful song. We're not promised tomorrow. We're not guaranteed a tomorrow. And if tomorrow didn't come, it's judgment day, and we don't know what day that's going to be. So help those that you see. When we see the need, don't put it off till tomorrow. I think about the Good Samaritan. Those first two people that saw that need, they went to the other side. They crossed on the other side. Probably did that. Out of sight, out of mind. But the Good Samaritan, he had a threefold action. He was moved to pity and he acted compassionately. And he went above and beyond giving. And this is a theme that's very common in the gospel. In Luke, Jesus saw a woman weeping at the death of her only son. And he brought her son back to life. When the father saw the prodigal son far off, he was filled with compassion and he ran to meet him. He didn't wait. Matthew and Mark say that on many occasions, Jesus saw the crowds and he had compassion on them and he healed them and he fed them and he taught them. Even many times, Jesus himself was tired, but never too tired to heal and show compassion. And here in the parable of the Last Judgment, what makes some blessed is the fact that though they didn't realize it at the time, they didn't know what they were doing. They were supplying a need, they were feeding and providing for the poor and helping them. They didn't know that they were helping Jesus himself. And I got to admit, many times in my life, I haven't always seen the face of Jesus when I've seen someone in need. I can remember several years ago, we were in Chattanooga. We were on a really, really, really tight budget. It's like it was tight. We probably shouldn't have taken the trip, but we needed a couple of days to get away. We had some things planned and some things that we wanted to do, and we were walking downtown, and there was a man that came up, and obviously, it just looking at him, I don't know that he had a home. And he was in need, and I saw him, and I didn't react. And Becca said to me, "Dad, can we help him out?" Of course, I was thinking about the budget. But then I said, "Sure, we can help him out." And I did. And later on in that trip, I think we found a coupon or something, and it saved almost the exact amount that I'd given that man. So looking back on that, I'm so thankful that my children see things sometimes that I don't see. And I'm thankful for that. Jesus is telling us how we will be judged. And it's not a pop quiz. He's giving us the answers right here. He wants us to pass the test, y'all. He wants us to be with him. He wants us to pass the test. And he's telling us what we have to do to be favorable, or to be favored on judgment day. We want to be on the right. And here's what's so amazing. The King of all kings, the Lord of all lords, I am himself, says, "I am that guy on the side of the road that's holding that sign that says, I will work for food." That's me. I'm the person that looks at you in a crowded supermarket with your buggy full of food. And they're standing there with just a few things. And you hear them tell their child that, "We can't get that today. We've got to wait till Friday." Jesus is the face of that couple that orders that one sausage and biscuit and something that's called a hobo float. That's water. Miss Becky out at Oakland said her husband used to call it earth juice or earth punch. But you see that. You see them share that one biscuit. That's a need. And God will point those needs out to you. Maybe we feel moved, but maybe we don't act as or move as the Good Samaritan did. No, not always. Without realizing it, those helping the poor, those helping those in need, they were helping Jesus. And that's what we're doing when we do that. And what makes the others cursed is that they saw a need and they didn't see Jesus. They didn't react with that same kindness. Jesus addresses each of the two groups as blessed or cursed. There's no in between. It's an either or. Can't be somewhere in the middle. He tells them how they will be judged. And both question their blessedness, but they question it for a totally different reason. Those that will be eternally punished. Those that will be eternally punished. They didn't know that was Jesus. Those that were blessed, they didn't know it was Jesus either. They just did good for goodness sake. They saw a need and they supplied the need. Jesus said, "You did for them, you did for me." And it's all about giving. And I thought about it's so easy to Google things and to get information. So I thought, wonder who the most generous people ever were. If you could compile a top 10 list of the most generous people of all time, and thank goodness on just about every one of those lists, Jesus Christ, the King of all kings, was number one. Thank goodness. I saw Mother Teresa on some, I saw Gandhi on some, and I saw James Christopher Harrison. Yeah, me too. I didn't know. I didn't have a clue who James Christopher Harrison was. He was born in 1936. He lives in Australia. And back here in the 1950s, they discovered that his blood plasma, there's a unique character, a healing character in his blood plasma. To this date, he's made 1,000 donations. 1,000. Now, he would do more, but you can only give every 2 to 3 weeks. He would give every day if he could. And that's amazing enough. But you see, his blood plasma, they discovered that the disease, there's an Rh disease. And if they can treat this disease with things from his blood, however that works, I don't know. 2.4 million babies are happy and healthy in the world today because of his blood plasma. And he's still giving. He's 80-something years old and he still gives. That just takes giving to a whole other level. To think that our 2.4 million people are alive because I did something simple like give blood. God works. And here's the thing. The kingdom of heaven shows up where we least expect it. Scriptures say like a thief in the night. The very presence of Jesus himself shows up in those faces. The face of the hungry, the sick, and the thirsty. How did Jesus come into this world? Hungry. Thirsty. Naked. Those seeing the need and acting with compassion are blessed. And this is an echo of the Beatitudes in Matthew 5. Those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, and those who are merciful, those who are pure in heart, those will be blessed. And here we are. Christ the King Sunday. The season of Advent just around the corner. And we know that the kingdom of heaven that Jesus has been talking about has come. The King is on his throne. His kingdom is here, but not quite in full power yet. That day will come. As sheep, we will be privileged to rule with the King of all kings. And this kingdom began with Jesus' birth, and it lives in our baptism. And this kingdom in all its power will come in final judgment. The last step is to be glorified. And more than 2,000 years ago, John the Baptist didn't say that the kingdom of heaven will happen in a couple thousand years. No, in Matthew 3:2, John says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." When Jesus sent his disciples out in Matthew 10, he gave them the power to heal and do the things that he did. Jesus told them when they heal and they spread the gospel to tell the people, "The kingdom of heaven is at hand. It's now." The same kingdom is here today. The King is here. He came to the earth, and we know through the genealogies in the Bible, all those names that are hard to pronounce for me. We know that he is of the kingly line because he was the king. Herod wanted him killed. At his death, even Pontius Pilate admitted, surely he was the king. And he sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And he rules both heaven and earth. He is here. He is wherever you are. He is the King. The King of all kings. And because he ascended into heaven, that doesn't mean that there's less of him here. It means that there's more of him here. Because he left us with a precious gift. The Holy Spirit that lives within us. Jesus proved his power over natural forces of land and sea, over the forces of darkness and sickness, and even death itself could not hold him. The same King comes to us every day. The same King that gave blind Bartimaeus back his sight. The same Lord that gave Lazarus back his life. That same King, the same Lord, our same Savior that wept tears of compassion is with us today. Then I think about every communion Sunday. I feel so much more connected. Think about that last supper that he had with his disciples. And what that meant to them and what it means to us. To have that part of him still with us. About 2:30 this morning, I had a little trouble sleeping. I was thinking about the message today, and I was just thinking, yeah, Lord, there's just something else I know you want me to say, I just don't know what it is. And as Hank Williams Sr. said about writing those great songs, he just held the pen, and I just held the pen at about 2:30 this morning and just let God write or give me the words. And I came up with just something kind of short called Crown of Thorns. Kings don't wash feet. Kings don't take the lesser seat. Kings have a palace in which to live. For my king, there was no room in the inn. Kings rule with power and authority. My king rules with grace and mercy. Kings say, you do things my way. My king says, I am the way. My king fed the hungry, healed the sick, and calmed the storm. My king wears a crown of thorns. He didn't live much like a king. Most of his life he spent without a home, depending on the generosity of others. But I say this, he is the greatest king of all time. Our king. And I declare today that Christ the King has died, and Christ the King has risen, and Christ the King will come again to judge us all. I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.